Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for our 2021 Care Partner Symposium, Finding Hope, Humor, and Heart in Caregiving. My name is Daniela Saylor, and I am one of our cognitive health advisors here in the Alzheimer's and Memory Disorders Program at the Barrow Neurological Institute in Phoenix. We have a wonderful lineup for you today. We have two wonderful speakers, Dr. Anna Burke and Elaine K. Sanchez. Our first speaker is Dr. Burke, but before I introduce her, I just want to go over a few housekeeping items. The first is that if you are present here with us today, it's likely that you registered for this event, and we hope you did, because every single person who registered, even if you're not able to attend, we will be mailing a copy, a complimentary personalized copy of Elaine's book, Letters from Madeline. We are so excited to be sending this out to you all, and we hope that you get a lot from it, from today's presentation, but also from this wonderful resource that Elaine has put together, and that she'll actually refer in her presentation as well. So today, for her part, Dr. Burke will be covering different topics related to caregiving and self-care, but she'll really delve a bit deeper in terms of what are the effects of not caring for ourselves as caregivers. And often we hope that you have heard this before, that as someone who is providing care for a loved one, that you are taking care of yourself, that you are taking time for yourself, if only a few minutes, half an hour, 1 hour, whatever it is that you're able to manage in that day, but that you're making your own health a priority. And we, some folks hear that before and they think, okay, that's great. But then the needs of our loved one, they can change from one moment to the next. Or we try to create routines, but we find it more difficult to actually follow through because we may not have control over our day the way we would like. And self-care tends to fall to later. It tends to be the thing that we leave for next weekend, and then next weekend becomes another weekend. So, really we wanted to not only, of course, encourage you to care for yourself, but provide a bit more information as to, what is caregiver burnout, if you've heard of that term before. How does it show up in our life? How do we know to recognize it? And what can we do to help ourselves and to be, more healthy ourselves, but also better caregivers in providing self-care for our own person. So she will tell you a lot more about that. So Dr. Anna Burke is the Director of Neuropsychiatry and of the Alzheimer's and Memory Disorders Division here at the Barrow Neurological Institute. She has extensive experience in clinical research, and she has led over 80 clinical trials in Alzheimer's and related dementias. She provides a lot of support for her patients here in the clinic and for their families. And part of her vision and part of the work that we move forward with here at Barrow is, not just supporting our patients, but also family members on this journey when the person receives a dementia diagnosis. And this very program is part of that mission. And the material that she'll cover really speaks to that as well. So with that said, I will pass the mic on to Dr. Burke.
Well, thank you, Daniela. Thank you for the kind words. So welcome to our presentation today. We're glad that you could join us. Today, we're going to be discussing a very important topic, one that probably many of you have been struggling with. Let me just make sure that we can see the presentation here. There we go. And you, I take it you can see the presentation? Daniela?
Yes, Dr. Burke, we can definitely.
Perfect. Great. Well, so today we're going to be talking about caring for yourself as a caregiver. And while we'll discuss strategies for caring for yourself, Elaine will discuss that a little bit later. I'll touch upon it during my discussion today. The initial part of our presentation is really going to be in understanding the ways that stress affects your brain and why it is so essential to care for yourself. We'll talk about some of the statistics out there. Oftentimes, as we're dealing with being a caregiver, we really feel alone, like there's nobody else who really understands what you're going through. And it's important to know that you are not alone. There are so many individuals that are dealing with this disease, and so many families and loved ones and caregivers behind them who are struggling in their own way. So as many of you already probably know, Alzheimer's is a crisis. It is really one of the greatest crises that is facing our society currently. Alzheimer's is the most common form of dementia. It accounts for anywhere from 60 to 80% of all dementias, even though there are different types of dementias that people can experience. We estimate that currently in the US, there are about 5.3 million Americans that are affected by this disease. And we know that those numbers are going to rise significantly over the next several decades as our population ages. By the year 2050, we estimate that up to 16 million Americans will suffer from Alzheimer's disease. Currently, even in just Arizona alone, there are anywhere from 120 to 150,000 individuals living with this disease. And behind every individual, behind everybody who is diagnosed with a dementia, there is a family, there is a caregiver. There is somebody who is also affected by this disease. We know that caregivers are really more prone to all kinds of problems, including becoming ill, including developing depression and other physical ailments. They're more prone to caregiver stress and caregiver burnout. And oftentimes they feel alone. They feel like there is no one there to support them. They feel like there is no one there to understand what you're going through. And the fact is, you're not alone. There are millions of caregivers out there. So first of all, it's important to note that this disease, Alzheimer's, really disproportionately affects women. Now, part of that is the fact that about two-thirds of individuals who are diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease are actually women. We're not quite sure exactly why that is. There are probably some changes that occur during menopause that predispose women to developing this disease. We know that the average individual who suffers from Alzheimer's disease will live probably anywhere from 4 to 8 years. Now, if you look at textbook progression of this illness, it's about 10 years from when people enter into the mild stages of illness till they pass away. But oftentimes they're not diagnosed in the early stages. They're diagnosed more into the moderate stages or kind of late mild stages. So the typical lifespan is about 4 to 8 years, although some individuals can live as long as 20 years. Which means those effects on the caregiver can be quite profound and quite long. We know that caregivers provide a lot of care that is not currently covered by various types of insurance and financial programs. And the strain on them, both physically as well as financially, is tremendous. So in 2012, 15 million Americans actually provided 17.5 billion hours of unpaid caregiving. And that care was valued at about $216 billion. Now, those costs are rising, again, as our population is aging and as the number of caregivers and patients with dementia increases. So who are the typical caregivers? Well, again, this illness tends to disproportionately affect women. We know that two-thirds of patients are women, but also 60% of Alzheimer's caregivers are also women. The typical family caregiver is a 50-plus-year-old woman caring for her widowed mother who doesn't live with her. Oftentimes, this caregiver is married and employed. Frequently, she has a family of her own. The caregivers are generally what we call the sandwich generation. They're trying to manage their own lives. They oftentimes have young families, and they're trying to care for their aging parent who is suffering from this disease. Over 40% of Alzheimer's caregivers say they had no choice in becoming a caregiver. They feel like this was just kind of thrust upon them, which contributes to a lot of the stress and the burnout that they experience as they take on this role. We know that one of the impacts on caregivers is the financial impact, and this can be quite significant. In 2008, the average family caregiver for somebody who was 50 years or older spent $5,531 per year out of pocket in caring expenses. Now, for most people, that's more than 10% of their median income. One study actually estimated that the total impact of Alzheimer's disease on government, on families, and businesses was around $300 billion per year. And again, those numbers are on the rise as those numbers of patients and caregivers increase. We know that those caregivers who are still working oftentimes feel the impact of their caregiving duties on their work. Almost two-thirds of caregivers report that they've gone into work late, they had to leave early, or they had to take time off to provide care. And numerous studies actually indicate that working caregivers feel overburdened. They receive too little support from their employers, and they're not considered as productive in the workplace, which oftentimes affects their ability for upward mobility, for continued growth and development of their careers, and obviously has a financial impact on them and on their families. 58% of caregivers provide more than 10 hours of care to a loved one each week. Again, unpaid care, and oftentimes care that comes at the expense of their careers. 16% of caregivers actually report that they've had to quit their jobs in order to be able to care for their loved one because that burden, that need became overwhelming. Now, we know that beyond the financial impact and the stress that comes with that, there's a significant impact on our health when we become caregivers. Our bodies are set up in a certain way where over thousands of years, we've developed different types of mechanisms for dealing with stress. Imagine our ancestors, when they were stressed, when they met a tiger or a lion out in the field, they had to react quickly. Their bodies went into what's called a fight or flight response, right? Where all of a sudden these hormones and chemicals would be released in their body, these stress hormones, that would help them to do one of two things. Either in that stressful situation, run away as fast as possible to preserve their lives, or to fight whatever that oncoming danger was. Now, that type of response still persists in our bodies. It helps us in emergency situations when we're in a car accident or somebody is attacking us. As long as this exposure to these stress hormones is brief, it doesn't really cause a problem. But what happens when you're constantly under stress? When you're constantly worrying about things, when you're a caregiver, for instance, and that stress level really never decreases. Well, that overexposure to those stress hormones, and in particular to a stress hormone called cortisol, can actually disrupt all of your body's processes. And that puts you at an increased risk of many health problems, including increased risk of anxiety, increased risk of depression. You can start to experience digestive problems like dyspepsia and diarrhea and irritable bowel syndrome. You can start to develop headaches. You're more prone to developing heart disease and cardiac problems. Your sleep becomes disrupted. You might start to notice that you're gaining weight because cortisol is involved in our insulin sensitivity as well. And it can start to affect your memory and your concentration, causing cognitive impairment. There are actually studies that show us that this constant bombardment of our brains by cortisol can actually shrink memory centers called hippocampi in the brain. Now, there are other impacts on your health if you are a caregiver. The health of caregivers tends to deteriorate as their loved ones or their care recipients' health declines. So 67% of caregivers note that they put off going to the doctor because they put their family first. The person that they're caring for comes first. They have so many appointments and so many things to take care of that they just don't have time for themselves. During an 18-month study of Alzheimer's caregivers, it was found that emergency room visits and hospital-based services, particularly among female caregivers, were twice that of non-Alzheimer's caregivers. Meaning oftentimes people put off that care, that visit to the primary care physician, that annual physical, taking care of that ache or pain or gastrointestinal symptom for so long that they reached a point where they couldn't ignore it anymore and they wound up in an emergency room or a hospital. The cost of the care during that time was $4,766 per year on average that healthcare that caregivers of Alzheimer's patients actually spent versus their non-Alzheimer's caregiver counterparts. Now, the impact of being a caregiver on health also is reflected in self-reports. 11% of family caregivers report that caregiving has caused them their physical health to actually deteriorate. 23% report that their health is fair to poor. And 63% of caregivers report that they have poor eating habits compared to non-caregivers. They may not take the time to focus on eating well or caring for themselves. 58% say that they don't exercise the way that they should. Their exercise habits start to deteriorate after they take on the duties of becoming a caregiver. Family caregivers experiencing stress tend to age prematurely. We know that being under that caregiver stress can subtract as many as 10 years from your lifespan. Now, there are also emotional and mental health aspects or stresses of being a caregiver. About 40 to 70% of family caregivers have clinically significant symptoms of depression. And up to 50% of these caregivers actually meet criteria for a major depressive disorder. 16% of caregivers feel emotionally strained, and 26% say that it's so hard on them emotionally. Caregiving may also cause a loss of sense of identity. So you no longer identify as Molly, but you identify as mom's caregiver. You may start to feel like you have a lower sense of self-esteem. You're constantly worrying and may experience more feelings of uncertainty. Caregivers also have higher levels of stress that, again, take a toll on their cognitive health. So we know that this constant stress, this constant anxiety, or even the development of depression and anxiety can result in an impact on your brain health. Over time, that cortisol, again, bombards your brain, and it starts to shrink your memory centers. So caregivers who experience chronic stress may actually score lower on cognitive tests and over time become more prone to developing cognitive impairment such as a dementia themselves. So as caregivers, over time, they may actually become the patients if they don't care for themselves. Caregiving also takes a toll on our relationships. It affects your relationship with the care recipient, such as a parent or a spouse, but it also affects other relationships. So 75% of adults caring for parents actually reported that it strained their relationships. 46% said it damaged not only their relationship with that parent, but also their romantic relationships, their marriages. In fact, 25% said that it played a major role in their divorce. So this obviously takes a toll not just on the caregiver, but on the family unit as a whole. You don't leave this at home. You bring it, or at your job as a caregiver, you bring this home to your family. You bring the stresses, the anxiety, and everything else into your relationship, and that can have a significant impact on your life. Caregiver burnout not only affects the care recipient, but the caregiver may actually withdraw from relationships with their spouse, with their children, with their friends. So it has a significant impact on that family unit. Now, if most of you are listening and you're kind of nodding your heads going, yep, that sounds like me, that sounds very familiar, there are things that you should be aware of. Most of us will actually oftentimes get lost in the role of the caregiver. And not only do we not take care of ourselves, but we tend to ignore some of the signs of caregiver stress. We tend to write them off. We tend to put them off because we're focusing on our loved one, right? But there are certain signs of caregiver stress that you should be looking for. So ask yourself, are you experiencing anxiety? Are you worrying a lot? Are you constantly, is your mind just going and you can't make it stop? You're worrying about the things that you have to do. You're worrying about the things that your loved one needs. You're worrying about the things that you've done wrong. Are you feeling depressed? Are you becoming more pessimistic and withdrawn? Are you finding it more difficult to find joy in life? Are you noticing that you're becoming more irritable? All of these can be signs of caregiver stress. Are you feeling tired and run down, like your batteries just can't recharge? Do you find yourself having a difficult time sleeping? Do you lie awake at night worrying about all of the things that you have to do the next day, or reliving the events of a given day, feeling guilty or wishing you had done something differently? Do you wake up in the middle of the night or earlier than you would like? Do you find yourself overreacting to minor nuisances, having a shorter fuse? Things that normally wouldn't set you off now really get you flying off the handle. Do you find yourself experiencing new health problems or worsening of your current medical conditions? Do you have trouble concentrating, just focusing, being able to multitask, being able to do the things that you need to do? Do you find yourself feeling increasingly resentful? If someone in your life is talking about something, a happy event or some kind of success, do you find yourself angry and upset about that? Or resentful of the fact that somebody doesn't have the burden that you do? Are you drinking more? Are you smoking more? Are you eating more? Are you relying on those stress relievers, if you will? Do you find yourself neglecting responsibilities or cutting back on leisure activities that you used to enjoy, hobbies, and get-togethers with friends? Those can all be signs of caregiver stress. Now, it's important to identify these symptoms or these signs of caregiver stress before they lead to caregiver burnout. With caregiver burnout, you tend to see that you have much less energy than you once had. It's like your battery just never recharges. You may find yourself having difficulty with catching every cold or flu or whatever virus is going around. And there's a reason for that. Cortisol, that stress hormone, can actually affect your immune system adversely. If you're under constant stress, your immune system actually dwindles. So you're going to be more prone to catching every cold and every flu and everything that's going around. So again, it can impact your health. Do you find that you're constantly exhausted, even after sleeping, even after taking a break? You just can't seem to find the energy. That can be a sign of caregiver burnout. Do you neglect your own needs, either because you're too busy or you don't care anymore? You've kind of lost the drive. Do you find that your life revolves around caregiving, but yet you find little satisfaction in this? Do you have trouble relaxing, even when help is available, even when somebody comes in to take care of your loved one? Do you find yourself still worrying that things aren't being done right or what the consequences of that care will be? Are you increasingly impatient and irritable with the person that you're caring for? Do you feel helpless? Do you feel hopeless? Those are all concerning signs of caregiver burnout. And if you are experiencing this, you really do need to seek additional support and help. But how do you avoid caregiver burnout? Well, one of the major factors that contributes to that sensation of caregiver burnout is feeling powerless. As I mentioned earlier, about 40% of caregivers say they feel like they've just been thrown into that position, that decision to become a caregiver was made for them. So one of the ways of overcoming that caregiver burnout is to take control of that choice. Embrace your choice of becoming a caregiver. You may not have had much of a say initially in becoming that caregiver. Mom or dad or your spouse may have just needed that care and you had to step in. But you chose to be the hero. You chose to be the one to step in and to care and to support your loved one, whether willingly or unwillingly. You did make that choice. Acknowledge that. Despite any resentments or burdens you feel, you have made a conscious choice to provide care. That's the first step in feeling more in control. Now, focus on the positive reasons behind that choice. Perhaps you provide care to repay your parent for the care they've given you all your life growing up. Or maybe it's because of your values or the example that you want to set for your children so that they, in time, if you require care, if others in their lives require care, they're able to step up to the plate and support them, their spouses, their parents, their loved ones. These deep, meaningful motivations can help sustain you during these difficult times. The other thing that is important to do is to focus on the things that you can control. There are a lot of things that can feel out of control and crazy when you're a caregiver. You can't wish for more hours in the day. You can't force your brother to help out more. But rather than stressing on all of these things that you can't control, focus on how you respond or react to problems. You can't control the situation, but you can control how you respond to it and how you experience it, if you will. Celebrate the small victories. If you start to feel discouraged, remind yourself that all of your efforts really do matter. Now, you can't cure your loved one's illness, but you can do small things to make a difference. And don't underestimate that making your loved one feel safe and comfortable and loved has an impact. Imagine how you would feel in that situation. If you were experiencing this illness, even that comfort of having that loving touch, that kind word, somebody to help you to make a meal or to help you get dressed, that would have a huge impact. You are making an impact on their lives. You are supporting them. Those are small victories to focus on. Studies do show that caregivers who feel appreciated experience greater physical and emotional health. So when was the last time that you actually met with somebody who reflected back all of the positive things that you're doing? This is where friends and family and even support groups come into play. It's important to be surrounded by people or at least have some exposure to people who are going to be able to tell you how well you're doing, that you're doing your best, and that your efforts really do have an impact, that they're meaningful. Also, imagine how your loved one would respond if they were healthy. Now, they're dealing with an illness, their brain is being injured. So perhaps they may not notice all of the things that you're doing. They may not remember all of the things that you're doing. They may even become upset with you because there are times when you have to say no and be the bad guy. But what would they say if their brains were healthy? If they could step back and they could look at everything that you're doing? Oftentimes, I suspect that they would have a tear in their eye and they would hug you and they would kiss you and they would tell you how much they loved you and how much they appreciated all that you're doing, all that you're sacrificing, all of the support that you're providing them. So applaud your efforts because you are making a difference. And be sure to talk to a supportive friend or family member, somebody again who's going to be able to reflect back all of the wonderful things that you are doing. Taking on all of the responsibilities of caregiving without regular breaks or assistance is really a surefire recipe for caregiver burnout. So remember, being able to take a break, being able to step back, is going to be a key factor in caring for yourself, but also caring for your loved one. Don't try to do it all alone. Look into respite care. Now, there are wonderful programs out there. There are adult day programs. There are in-home caregiving services that you can take advantage of. But also, there are friends and family members and maybe people through your church or other organizations that could help you, that can give you that break that you need and that respite that you need. Don't be afraid to ask them. Don't be afraid to speak up. Oftentimes, we really do expect others to just kind of know what we need and automatically know what we're feeling. That's not the case. Most family members, most friends don't really know how best to help. They want to help, but they just don't know what they can do. So don't be afraid to ask for help. Don't be afraid to tell them what you need. Oftentimes you will find that they will step up to the plate and they'll try to support you as best they can. Also, spread the responsibility and be willing to relinquish some control. So when you bring in a caregiver for that much needed respite that you have, whether it's your brother or your adult child, don't sit there and worry about the fact that they're not doing things the way that you would like, or that they're not doing things right. It's oftentimes very difficult for us to just let people help us. We worry that they're not going to provide the same level of care or support or the perfect type of day that we, or routine or schedule that we've been providing to our loved one. But don't let perfect be the enemy of good. Good is good enough sometimes. The fact that you're able to step back and to have that respite time, and that somebody is going to come in and give you that break, that's important. That's vital. And yes, it may not be a perfect day, but it doesn't matter. It's good enough. Allow that to be good enough. Say yes when somebody offers assistance. And remember that taking time to care for yourself is not a selfish act. It's a necessity. If you don't care for yourself, you won't be able to care for your loved one the way that you hope that you could. You won't provide the level of care that you could if you were taking breaks. There's a difference between being busy and being productive. If you're not regularly taking time off to de-stress and to recharge those batteries, you'll end up accomplishing less in the long run. You may be busy throughout the day, but you're so drained that you're just not able to be productive. So make sure that you are taking advantage of that respite and taking advantage of breaks. Schedule some time for activities that you enjoy. Make sure that you're maintaining your personal relationships. So get together with a friend for coffee or go for a walk. Take that art class or spend some time reading a good book. You need that time to recharge. Make yourself laugh. Laughter is actually amazing. It has a tremendous impact on our brains. So when we laugh, our brains release feel-good chemicals called endorphins, and that helps us feel better. It helps kind of quell that fire that comes with stress. So if you imagine that cortisol release being that fire, those endorphins that come with laughter and with activity actually help to put out that fire. Now, that means you can go see a wonky movie, a good comedy. You can go for a stand-up comedy show. But even making yourself laugh, even forcing yourself to smile can have a huge impact on how your brain feels and how it reacts. For instance, there have been studies that have shown us that even a fake smile tends to activate muscles that send feedback to your brain, letting it know that you feel good. Now, you may not feel good. You may be smiling for no apparent reason, but your brain doesn't know that. Your brain thinks, gosh, well, we must be feeling good. So let's release those feel-good chemicals. And in the long run, that helps reduce stress. Take care of your own health. Keep up with your doctor's visits. Exercise, eat well. Again, exercising tends to release endorphins. That's why we feel better after a walk. We feel more energized. We feel like our minds are clearer. Be sure to pencil that into your day. Take a few minutes for daily relaxation practice. Look into yoga or meditation, or even just simply deep breathing. That can help reduce your stress. And be sure not to forget to get enough sleep, not just in terms of the hours that you sleep, but in terms of quality sleep. If you're not sleeping well, if you're not rested, you're going to be more likely to become irritated, more likely to have difficulty focusing, more likely to be stressed and to respond adversely during the difficult times that come during the day as a caregiver. And remember, join a support group. One of the best things that you can do is to meet people who are experiencing the same thing that you're going through, because this is the community that helps kind of give you a pat on the back and say, look, you're doing things right. You're doing a great job. They help you with ideas about how you can handle some of the stresses in life. They help you with ideas about how you can care for your loved one. So build that community. Be part of that community. Don't be afraid to go out there and join one of the support groups. And with that, I am going to end my presentation and hand it over to Elaine, who's going to take over our next part of how to care for yourself as a caregiver.
Thank you so much, Dr. Burke, for that wonderful presentation. I know that some of the statistics and some of the facts can be sobering, but for myself, for my part, I know that it's very helpful to know what some of the effects are and to have an idea of how I can move forward with self-care beyond just a sort of an abstract concept of take better care of yourself. Well, what does that actually look like? And not everybody likes bubble baths or scented candles, which we see often, you know, in different media, in the media, but, you know, it can be laughter. It can be just time to ourselves, and it can be something that is very much our own. So thank you again, Dr. Burke.